That is my own face. I am not sure if they're just going to pop Shelly in or what's going
on. Hey, guys, how's it going? Sorry, I was going to do my costume change. But then I was like, you know what?
Please don't. Your jacket is incredible.
Oh, man, thanks. I only wear it on game shows and game show-related panels. Thanks a lot for joining us here, guys. Can't thank you enough. I'm going to go ahead and bring Shelly on, and you guys can rock and roll.
Hey, sounds great.
Hey, Shelly.
Hi. Vita.
Shelly. I think it's just they're just having to start right out the gate. We're just going to rock and roll. So I guess I'll give you a little intro, and then we'll just jump right into the questions. I know that there are also there's a public chat side, so we'll be able to see questions that kind of pop up there. So, yeah. All right.
Fun.
For those of you who do not know who Shelly Bond is, you're about to find out. It is my great honor to be able to edit, to talk to one of the best editors in the business. One of the best editors.
Oh, make me blush. Make me blush.
That's my job, right? Shelly Bond has been working in comics since the 90s. She has worked for companies like DC. I'm sure that's the one that people have been talking about. She has worked for IDW, had her own imprint there. Black Crown, some of the best independent books that, look at that, she's got it all set up.
Thank you.
She's currently editing, freelance editing, yes, Bitterroot over at Image Comics, the critically acclaimed Bitterroot. Some of the books that she has gently, yes, I was hoping you'd have a pile of
them. I told you I was going to bring visual aids today. I did not let you down, Vita.
Thank you. I appreciate you. I'm also not tech savvy, so that's why she has the visual aids. She has put together anthologies such as Insider Art. Do you have your very, very sexy Hey Amateur next to you as well?
Yes. Why, yes, I do. And in fact, Vita, just because I don't want to take center stage for the whole hour, I'm hoping we'll get a chance to explain this.
I have been blessed to work with Shelly on two anthologies now, actually, which has been really awesome. She has been responsible for resurrecting people's careers back from the dead, or so it says on her resume.
I like the sound of that.
Listen, I laughed because I was like, you know what, this is accurate. And also just bringing you books that have changed the shape of comics. Books like Fables, books like House of Mystery, which is one of my personal favorites that you've done. That book absolutely changed the way I thought about comics. You know, books like Scene of the Crime. Didn't you put together the dream team?
I did. Wow. You're really taking me back, but yes. A team. Ed Brubaker, Michael Lark, and Sean Phillips. And I think Ed and Sean might have gone on to do one or two things after that.
I suppose.
Duh.
They did things together. So thank you for that. Thank you for all of the things that I have not mentioned as well. Instead of me just listing all the things you've done, I want to get into the questions. I'll keep an eye on that side chat just to see if anyone else has any questions. I wanted to kind of start a little softer before we get into the nitty-gritty. You know, I talked a little bit about your resume. Your resume is amazing. It calls you a mad scientist and a mod curator. So before we get
I'm not sure who came up with that, by the way.
No.
I sent the resume to the printer and that's how it came back. So I'm kind of just running with it.
It was blank paper and then it came back and it was incredible.
Pretty much.
You're too modest. You're entirely too modest. But I wanted to talk a little bit first about what being an editor means, because I think that there's a lot of misunderstanding about what it is that people like you do. So if you could kind of talk a little bit about what you think makes a good editor.
Sure. Well, I used to say that editing comics was the greatest job that no one knows about, but that was very true probably in the 90s. But today it's definitely much more commonplace. You know, we have so many different ways to get work published. So, you know, back in the day, you either had the big two, the big corporations, or you had indie publishers. And a lot of the self-publishing that was done was sort of under the radar. I think what's so exciting about working in comics today is that the tables have turned and self-publishing, whether you do it on your own DIY or whether you go to a crowdfunding site like Kickstarter or Indiegogo, you can really make a comic today. And that's the most exciting thing about being in comics right now. But going back to editing, Vita, one of the things I always say to people is that being the editor of a comic book means you're the boss, you're master control. So if you open up a comic and the cover got you in, you like the artwork, you find the story compelling, you find the lettering easy on the eye, and you can read a comic straight through, see my name in the credits. I'll take all the props for that. However, if you pick up a comic book and you absolutely don't know where to look because there are too many word balloons bouncing off into your face, if the color looks more like you just ate a bag of Skittles and threw up, or if you can't for the life of you figure out who the main character is and what the story's about, see my name in the credits. The editor is in charge, and the editor has to assume responsibility for the good and the bad in every single comic book, every single graphic novel, every aspect of the page. So on the one hand, the editor has to be bossy. The editor has to be fearless. You know, a lot of times, like any business, it's about negotiating. You know, you, when you're working with a team, you know, editing comics is like juggling plates of fire. You are managing so many different people, not only as a part of the team of one book, but in an anthology, you sometimes have 150 people like we did in Insider Art. So you have to be really comfortable juggling. And you have to realize that there's triage. You know, you have a finite amount of time to actually call a page a finished page. So it's a lot more than being part copy editor, part art director, part enthusiast, part psychiatrist. What you're not great at, you have to fake, because you have to be a Jill of all trades to be a great comic book editor. And the one thing it's not is paper pushing. And I've seen over the years that the art of editing, the very craft, has sort of been pushed under the table. And that's really a crime. It's an editorial crime. And I say that as I'm wagging my red pen, because an editor is just as much a collaborator on a comic as a letterer or colorist or artist or writer. And there's nothing I like more than talking about what it means to be an editor, and it means everything.
So I think that kind of leads into my next question. I was actually talking in preparation for this. I listened to a bunch of interviews and I talked to a few people because I was really nervous about it.
What? You nervous? I find that shocking.
I am full of anxiety, much like almost every creator. But one of the things that kind of kept coming up when I was either hearing about you or talking with people about you was your voice. So your voice comes through very clearly in the comics that you make. And I think, you know, what I'm interested in is when you sit down to collaborate on a comic, what is your mission statement as an editor? Like, what are you setting out to do?
Ultimately, I am setting out to elevate the art form. To me, comics is the ultimate art form. I studied filmmaking in college. I love television. I was part of the MTV generation. And I love music and comics equally. So my mission in life is always to combine my two great loves. And I think that's what Black Crown was all about. It was my way to take everything that has made me who I am from the moment I heard David Bowie on the radio in 1974. I've been very charmed, as you know, by all things English. I not only married my favorite comic book artist who's British, but most of the music I listen to, I'd say 98% is by British bands. So it's part of my ideal and my aesthetic. So for me as an editor, I am always not only looking for something that captures the pulse of now or 5 minutes into the future, but something that captures our times by way of anything to do with pop art. And by that, I don't just mean something that's Warholian, that's an appropriation of something else. I think we should always be thinking about paying it forward, taking the best things about the art form and actually utilizing them to take a step into the next wave of comics. So yeah, I just like to think my comics have motion. They've got a vibe or a verve about them and an attitude. I like to think that they're urgent and frenetic. Not unlike my favorite frontman from a band, who I'll let you guess who that is. We've already prepped you with this, but tell me, can you recall?
I feel like we have to wait because I know that we're going to ask that question at the end. So I know that.
Okay.
I wanted to shout out Lord Crispy Nug. Thank you so much. They say, I love Shelly's Hey Amateur. It's a book that I know you worked really hard on putting together and getting out into the world. So that's really nice.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was a blast. It really was a blast. And we put this out on Kickstarter. We did the hardcover on Kickstarter. The soft cover is going to be available through Black Crown. It's the very last book from the Black Crown imprint, which, by the way, that was the greatest experience I've ever had in comics, working with Chris Ryle. And of course, my husband, Philip Bond, was the creative director, and all of the tremendous artists and writers who worked with us in those 3 years. We had 10 trades in 3 years, and many of them were nominated for awards. Got a chance to work with that creep David Lapham again, who, as everybody knows, my favorite comic book is Stray Bullets. I am not receiving payback from the Lapham estate. I'm not on their payroll, but I always tell people, if you want to get into crime comics, there is no other. It's Stray Bullets. It will not let you down. It will keep you up at night, in fact.
I wanted to kind of jump off of hearing you talk about some of the people that you've worked with, I mean, multiple times in the past. I know that one of the things that you really pride yourself on is being able to spot talent, you know, sometimes where others might not. So I wanted to talk about that a little bit. Let's get into like what you do specifically as an editor. What does it mean, you know, to you? What is it about certain creators that kind of ping that sense of, oh, I want to work with this person, or they will be good at something? And kind of talk to me a little bit about developing talent. I know we had this conversation off camera like yesterday, so I wanted to get back into that.
Hey, all good. It's one of my favorite things about working in comics. You know, it's bringing people together. It's connections. And one of the tenets of Black Crown was not just to merge music and comics, but actually my secret mission was to take a lot of the veteran creators that I worked with over the years and actually shake them up a little bit. You know, people as they age like to work on things that are familiar and comfortable. And that's the one place I don't want to go with a lot of writers and artists who I've worked with for 15, 20 years. There's nothing I like more than to actually grab them by the lapel, often kicking and screaming, into the now or into the future. And what I tend to do, and I did this at Black Crown, I did this on Hey Amateur, is I tend to unite a neophyte, someone new in comics, with one of the more veteran voices. So I did it with Kid Lobotomy, with Peter Milligan and Tess Fowler, which I think was a hell of a shakeup and a really terrific result with that book. Teeny Howard, who wrote both Assassinistas and Euthanauts. On Assassinistas, she worked with Gilbert Hernandez, who I bow to and salute as one of the masters. He was one of the reasons that I got into editing comics. I discovered Love and Rockets in the late 80s, and I love Jaime's work, but it was Gilbert's work that made me say, whoa, this is monumental. There was a surrealist edge to his storytelling. And I loved avant-garde filmmaking. I was a big fan of the French New Wave. And at that time, I was studying screenwriting. And I was reading comics, and I thought, wow, I can't write or draw, but maybe the editing that I've been learning in college, whether it was videotape editing, audio tape, or hot splicing film, maybe that can translate to comics. And 32 years later, here it is. So that's really what I do. I love spotting talent. Sometimes at 50 feet, sometimes I look at a portfolio and I see one tiny kernel, one facial expression, the way somebody has drawn shoulders or eyebrows, or the way that someone actually colored a scene. I find in comics, people that get their hands on a computer tend to overcolor. They think sometimes they have to show off all of the different tools that they can use. way too many types of modeling, when in fact, most people forget that white is a color. So we don't need a rainbow spectrum to connote ambiance on a page. So it's often the nuance, the subtle things in both a piece of artwork or in somebody's writing, because I think most people tend to overwrite in comics. And I think it's people, I look for people that have guts, people that are not afraid to put their work out there, and people that actually have something to say. And I always like to tell people when they're writing a story, write the story that keeps you up at night that only you can tell. Make sure it's personal, because we've seen all of those stories before about good versus evil, order versus chaos, heaven and hell. We've been there 1,000 times. What can you bring to a familiar trope that turns it sideways and then kicks it in the teeth? Those are the kind of people I like to work with, and those are the kind of books I like to put my imprimatur on.
And you know, you talk a lot about developing people, about spotting people, about seeing like kind of the diamond in the rough. What is it about working and mentoring newcomers to comics that appeals to you? Why is that something you clearly value? That you clearly spend a lot of time, you know, ushering in the next wave of people. Why is that something that you want to do?
Well, thank you for noticing that, because I feel like there are a lot of posers out there. There are so many people, so many editors, so many companies who claim that they're into diversity and inclusion. The proof is always in print. You know, when you can hold up a book like this and you can say 272 pages of female and non-binary creators came together to do insider art, I don't need to say two words. Here's the proof. But I think what we see are a lot of people just flapping their gums and saying, oh yes. And what they're really doing is filling buckets and ticking off on their to-do list. Oh yes, I've reached out to a person of this gender, a person of this age group. Now my book is complete. Well, I challenge those people to really sit back and think about it, because unless you're really publishing those people and unless you're walking the walk, you're doing a disservice to yourself and to the industry if you're not showing us the goods.
Yeah, I don't want to spend too much time just talking about one thing, but I really could talk about kind of the value of finding new people and mentoring them forever. And part of what you just said too, kind of a doing a disservice to, you know, people, if you just are trying to check a box, you're not really helping them thrive in the industry. You're just like, and I'm done, I'm not even going to bother with you. And so one of the things that I did notice about you and that I really appreciate, not just in working with you myself, but in looking at kind of your whole body of work, is that you get in there, you roll up your sleeves, and you're like, all right, we're making this together. Like you said, you know, your name's going to be on it. So, you know, you're going to do the best job possible.
Well, one of the things I wanted to mention, Vita, which is so important, the reason I feel so driven to make comics, even as a freelancer now, and I might be the first freelance editor who letters. It's kind of like if you think about a dancer who can also act. I feel like over the past 3 years, I've been sort of teaching myself other aspects of making comics. And it's been such a delight to get my hands on the Adobe Creative Cloud program and actually not only letter, but do design, because I've always been accused of being a frustrated art director. And when people would tell me that, I would look at them in the eye and I'd say, but editing comics is art directing. If you don't have a strong visual acuity, you better get one. That's another thing that I see happening a lot. You have editors who don't understand all aspects of the job, and they might be afraid to art direct because they don't know the difference between a vanishing point and a horizon line. Well, the solution is very simple. Ask someone, look it up, take a course. You know, I taught myself how to letter, and I actually asked both Aditya Bidikar and Todd Klein to look at my first samples for some feedback. And I think Todd actually in particular found it particularly thrilling because it was his chance to edit me for a change. But there's no stopping you now. So part of chatting with you today, Vita, is my way of looking everybody in the eye out there in comics and saying, no excuses. If you want to create comics, you can do it now, but you got to do it. You have to show up and do the work. And that's sometimes the hardest thing of all. An editor can hold you accountable, and that's super important, but still the idea and the determination comes down to you, and you have to make it happen. And I really am only interested in working with fearless people who want to create new things, who want to represent new voices. What I wanted to say is I think one of the reasons why I'm particularly interested in developing and working with the new generation is because I have a lot to learn from that generation. I have a 16-year-old son, but there's like plenty I've learned from him regarding his type of music and gaming. But there's a whole new wave of artists and writers who are coming in right now, particularly out of the UK. I haven't seen such an astounding group of talent since the mid-90s. And I really wanted to get my hands on them. I wanted to be a part of their scene. I wanted to find out what makes them excited to create comics. That's why, part of the reason why Insider Art came about, because everybody was on lockdown. We were 1 month into the pandemic. There was tons of vitriol, and I wanted to take that negative energy and I wanted to put it into a positive space. So ultimately, I asked 8 editors to join me, but we all edited 30 pages each of comics and prose and games. And basically, that's what became Insider Art. We put it up digitally on Gumroad. We told people they could pay what they wanted. And again, it was a group of people from around the world, from Greece and South Africa, Denmark, London, Canada, you name it. We have people from representing all different walks of life, female and non-binary. We raised over $6,000 for female and non-binary comic book retailers. And we also put this in print through Kickstarter. But the one thing I've been trying to say, Vita, I apologize I'm so long-winded. The reason I love paying it forward is because I was so lucky that when I started in comics in 1988 at Comica, the comic company, I had some great mentors. One of them was Rick Taylor, who I will still say is the greatest mentor on earth. He was the art director, and he really took me under his wing, handed me a Winsor Newton paintbrush, showed me what Doc Martin water dyes were all about, and said, here, paint this page. This is how we color comics. He showed me the color wheel, and he taught me how to memorize codes. Because back in those days, we didn't have computers. So we literally, we would look at a painter's colors on paper. We would draw with pencil a very fine line, and we would color code the book. So you would have 100% yellow, 100% red. So that was a bright red color. We would have to learn different shades. So it took a very long time to like mark up an issue of a comic book. But he not only taught me that, he taught me how to he taught me the basics of graphic design. You know, I had a lot of art classes in film school, but he really showed me the ropes when it came to lettering and type and burnishing letter columns onto paper. And, you know, so many elements of comics I had no idea made up the actual comic page. And also, in addition to Rick, of course, Matt Wagner is someone who I considered a great mentor. I was a huge fan of Grendel in college. So the idea that I was working for the company that actually published Grendel made my knees knock. And Matt was so amazing. I was basically the editorial assistant for Kamiko. So I answered phones and I stuffed envelopes and I sent out rejection letters. But Matt was always open to my questions. So if I had a few minutes to chat with him on the phone, he was so generous with his time. And over the years when I would work with him, whether it was on Sandman Mystery Theater or on Madame Xanadu, I got a chance to work with him again. He always took the time to share his knowledge of the craft. And he's really one of the greatest draftsmen, whether it comes to composition or storytelling and being a fearless writer. I mean, Matt's the whole package. And one of my favorite things he taught me was always, when you're looking at a page and you're trying to decide if there's, you know, a good page balance, he always said, pick one panel that's your beauty panel and spend a lot of time on the one panel, everything else will fall into place, but you can't spend 2 days on every panel. You know, comics are organic, but they're a ticking clock. And I think that in classic comic style on monthly books, you really didn't have time to lose, or the next person in line would have to rush, or you just might not make your deadline. And your deadline means your book wouldn't ship on time. So Matt was always the best with sharing a lot of the, you know, tips and tricks of the trade that worked for him, which in turn informed my editing. And I like to think my type of editing is very specific because, you know, like you've intimated, I'm really hands-on. My type of editing is not for the faint-hearted. I tell it like I see it. And that's so critical. It's the trust that you have with an editor has to be 100%, and it has to work both ways. And it always starts with respect. So, you know, there were some editors from like the 80s. I remember Denny O'Neill was famous for saying that editors, their best job is to hire the right people. I'll say yes and more. You know, you should always hire the right people for the job, but if they're not working out, you should fire them and fire them fast and then move on. Because the comics imperative is forward motion and everything needs to move forward, or you're going to just, you know, you're not going to have a comic. You're just going to have a lot of disparate parts that aren't meshing together. And when things connect and come together and get into a groove, that's when you see magic in comic books.
Three questions already like spun out, you know, as you were talking, and they're kind of different. So I'm struggling to figure out which one I want to ask first. But I think maybe the first question I wanted to ask kind of dovetails out of that, which is about collaborating, about, you know, what makes a good collaboration? What are you looking for in collaborators? Not just people who are going to be working with you, but working with each other. You know, a big part of what you do as an editor, especially when doing more corporate comics, which you have a lot of experience with, is to, you know, put together a team, assemble a team. So when you're doing that kind of stuff, what are you looking for? What, you know, you have enough experience that I feel like you can answer this question in a way that
is like, I'll give it a shot. I can only speak for myself. Look, editors need sharp instincts, and you got to trust your gut. You know, again, you're gonna take the crown and you're gonna take the fall if it doesn't work out. But you got to be able to take those chances. You have to be a risk taker. For me, being the editor of a book that has many different contributors, you have to be a really strong middle person, and you have to be able to keep secrets. So to me, I think a lot of the reasons why some of the indie comics struggle is because a lot of writers and artists work with their friends. And that can be great if you can both take criticism well and you both know how to give and take. It's the happy compromise I think we always need to strive for. So as the editor of, let's say, a book like Fables, where we had writer Bill Willingham and we had Mark Buckingham as a penciler, Steve Lealoha as the regular inker, Todd Klein as the letterer, Lilo Ridge as the colorist, I need to be mission control. I need to communicate with everybody on the team. So I bring good news and bad news. You have to be able to deliver all the information quickly. You have to make sure you're very clear, and you have to make sure that people are reasonably happy. And when you're putting together a book, you have to take personalities into consideration. So sometimes you've heard a creator is difficult. So what I try to do is try to find out why. You know, there have been people who are rumored to be, you know, pain in the butt to work with, but unless I've actually had a conversation with that person, I'm not going to trust the media, as it were. So I think it really is the pairings of eclectic people that truly elevate the art form. And that's why I think with Hey Amateur, I was able to do that. I was able to put someone like you, Vita, who's a tremendous writer, who, by the way, I hope we can actually bring you into the conversation and specifically what you are doing in comics and for comics as a voice and as a talented writer. But I paired you up with Eduardo Medeiros, who is a Brazilian cartoonist. Incredible. You might not have ever known he existed. And there's nothing more exciting, right? There's nothing more exciting to me than if I know a terrific South African painter and you know a tremendous young writer from Brooklyn who writes prose, but she wants to write comics. Let me bring those two people together and see how they can collaborate on the page. But I think the common denominator that everybody in comics needs to have is the ability to work well together. And that does mean that you're not going to always get your way. And it means that when you pass the baton, you know, you have to take it and run. And I remember one of my favorite things Neil Gaiman always said was, the difference between writing a novel and writing a comic book is that when you're writing a novel, it's a very intimate relationship that the writer is having with the reader. And of course, the editor. I don't want to take the prose editor out of the equation, but it's a little bit different. You know, when you're a prose editor and you have a manuscript, you're one-on-one with your writer as well. But when you're working on a comic book script, you know, you are writing for a team. And when that script leaves your hands and goes to the artist, you have to understand that the way you describe a window on a house might be drawn a lot differently than you described it. You cannot cry. And I have been in those situations, Vita, I can count them on more than one hand, where I've worked with novelists who would receive the artwork back and tell me the art was wrong. And then it's my job as the editor to explain, well, it's not wrong, it's a different interpretation, but perhaps it's even stronger because not only do we have these beautiful ornate windows, but we have op art curtains in the windows. So now we've got a great 60s lounge vibe. And this is so cool. And I can't wait to see how the inker then takes the pencils. Maybe the inker will put a slick polish on it, or maybe Bill Sienkiewicz will be the inker and he'll start throwing and flicking spatter at it. That's how art happens. It happens organically and it happens fast, and it's invigorating.
Absolutely. I think one of the very first lessons that I learned in comics was as the writer, I don't draw at all. A lot of you know, comics writers actually do draw or design. I don't. I'm not that kind of person. I'm not that cool. So the first lesson that I learned basically was whatever I put on the page, the artist is going to make it better. They are the visual part of comics, and comics are a visual medium. And so, you have to just let go of that control. And it was really free.
Yeah.
It was really, really like delightful to be able to go, oh yeah, that's their job. I give them what they need to do, what they need to do.
And you brought up a really great point. So let's say the artist actually did a terrible job. And let's say you actually asked for a woman to be wearing a V-neck t-shirt, and the artist gave them a crew-neck t-shirt, and you really wanted someone's tattoo to show at the top. That's when the editor comes in and says, okay, we do need changes, because the artist ignored something that was really critical to the character or the story. So I do think that it's important to point out that my job as an editor is, when you're happy, then I'm probably doing my job. But if you're unhappy, I need to know why. And I need to try to find a way to find a middle ground so that everyone's happy. But at the end of the day, make no mistake, the editor has to keep the quality of the story and the comic book, the actual art, at the front. So my job as the editor is to make sure you're telling your best story and that it's being visually represented the best way possible. And even if that means pissing you off a little bit, we all have to let go. And even as an editor, there were times, and I will confess to this, that I sometimes would get a little too self-indulgent myself, and I would sometimes get a little bit too much of a bully. And I think over the years, I've realized that editors also have to kind of let go a bit, because it isn't my story. I think as I've been writing comics this past summer, I've realized that more and more. And I highly recommend that editors, even if it's just for a day or for a week, to challenge themselves to learn how to letter a page, to write a comic book script. If you can't draw, just work with shapes. You know, I am certainly by no means an artist, but, you know, I have lots of really rough illustrations around me because I just, you know, I still can think with color and shape. And that's sometimes enough when you're trying to block a scene.
This is for the people that are watching. I have a bunch of questions that I've written out, but I always go off script. So apologies. But, you know, I wanted
Here's
to-
proof. I want to show them proof. See?
I did my homework, kind of. I wanted to kind of dig in a little bit more and talk about notes. I think that for me, one of the hardest things that I learned how to do, and I don't know if I've done it well, is to learn how to see the note beyond the note. And I think that's something that gets, like that saying gets thrown around, but if you could talk a little bit about the purpose of your notes when you're giving notes and why you would give a general note versus a specific one, like what is that tool for you?
Well, everybody has a different editing style. And my editing style is all about how does the script make me feel? So I have a really particular method. I'm a systems person, so there's always a method to my madness. The way that I sit at my desk, and it's always been this way, by the way, even before computers, I would set up my area of working like a little spaceship. I'd have things within my reach because you never have any time to waste when you're editing 6 to 7 monthly comics. So I was always used to having all my tools around me, my dictionary, my thesaurus, my stapler. I'd have a calendar on the wall, which I actually moved right now, but I can assure you that right here was my gigantic calendar, which I took from my very first boss, Diana Schutz. She used to have a giant desk calendar on her desk. And I still think that's a great way to put your really critical deadlines in red so you won't forget them. When I edit, the first thing I do, I take a script, I sit on my hands, I kid you not, and I read the script straight through. And I'm always tempted to grab my red pen because it's always on me. But first read of any comic book script is, I just want to read it. And that tells me everything I need to know about how much work I'm going to be putting into the editing. If I read it and suddenly I think I want to make a cup of coffee, or if I remembered that I have to turn a side over on an album that I was listening to, anything that stops me from reading the script, I know is like danger. I know I'm going to be editing for probably a day or two. And that usually means there are structural problems, there are too many panels per page, I'm not quite sure what the story's about, I don't even know if there's a beginning, much less a middle or an end. That first read is everything. In some cases, it can be deceptive because there have been so many wonderful writers over the years who write a hell of a script that's fun to read, but couldn't be drawn, because there might be 2 or 3 actions per panel on a page, or there might be 10 panels on every page and no splash pages. So that first read sitting on your hands, that just gives you the lay of the land and shows you how to budget your time for the next couple of days. After that first read, I'm allowed to pick up my red pen. But instead of just going in for the kill and starting to correct typos and just starting to, you know, notate what I like or what I don't like, that's when I block the actual script. So I do a beat sheet. Are you familiar with a beat sheet, Vita?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I think I learned how to do that from editors. I only can do the one thing. And so I ask questions about everything else just to make sure that I'm not making other people's lives more difficult. So.
Oh God, no. No, for sure. Well, when I do a beat sheet and I do it the most basic way possible, I number from 1 to 22, I count the panels per page. Yep. You know, you generally want 5 panels, but an average of 5 panels per page. And that was a Bill Willingham tip. Long ago, I was Bill's editor on The Elementals. And one of the things I remember he told me was that most of his stories are 5 panels. Most of his comic book issues are generally 5 panels per page. You have a few pages that might have more. 6 or 7 panels, maybe a 9 panel grid. And then you have 1 or 2 pages that are less, a splash page or a double page spread. And that's the law of averages. And it's good to stick to that. Then you get a nice rhythm throughout your comic. at that stage, I'm also going through and I'm trying to figure out how many scene changes I have, because so many comics start off with a very long scene, and I can't tell you how many I have edited that are 8, 9, 10 pages. That's practically half the comic. So, you know, you can see a lot of trouble ahead if in your first three pages, you don't have a lot of interesting things happening. And it was the old rule of thumb that if somebody walks into a comic book store and can read the first three pages, they'll either take the comic to the register or they'll put it back on the shelf. So those first three pages are critical. They don't have to always be very linear. They don't have to be the very first part of the story, but they need to grab you. They need to shake you up. They need to linger and taunt and tempt you to continue reading, no matter the subject.
You give a lot of really good advice. I'm jumping ahead to something that we were talking about when we were off camera yesterday, but is there going to be a vehicle for you giving advice to people or kind of sharing more of what you have learned with people that are interested beyond this very short panel?
I'm really glad you brought that up. Over the past year, I've had such a blast, not only freelance editing Bitterroot, which, by the way, I'm so proud of the Bitterroot team. And if anybody watching now wants to hear me talk less and listen more, I'm hosting a panel tomorrow with my incredible Bitterroot creators, Sanford Green, David Walker, and Chuck Brown. And it's tomorrow at this time, 5 o'clock Eastern, 2 o'clock Pacific. And I'm getting the honor of bossing them around again, but on a panel. And also I'm going to try to trick them into revealing some of their secrets about Bitterroot. So let me just say that freelance editing is only amazing when you have a team like the Bitterroot team. They're just tremendously talented and then super cool guys telling a story that is so vital and so important for everyone to read right now. And can I just say, I'm so proud of them for winning the Eisner for Best Continuing Series. And we've got a lot of fun things to talk about tomorrow at our panel and some sneak peek artwork to show. So, but back to your question, Vita. Over the past year, I've not only been freelance editing, but I've been doing quite a bit of writing. I've been working on my memoir, Filth and Grammar. I've been chipping away at it for years. I started it in earnest right as I pitched Chris Ryle at IDW, the Black Crown imprint. And I knew I couldn't do both. So I sort of put the memoir to the side, ran Black Crown for 3 years, no regrets. That was the right decision. But now that I've had a little bit more time on my hands, I've been going back to Filth and Grammar, and it's a graphic memoir. So it's part comic book short stories, part prose and single illustration, and part experimental. So I've got this corporate game board from hell, which is a lot of fun. I've hired so many new and up and coming artists, mostly female artists, a lot of people from England, I'm not gonna lie, still the Anglophile, a lot of talented South African artists, and also American artists and Canadian artists, but so proud of it. So I'm still chipping away at that. And I'm also writing what I'm calling right now, working title, The Elements of Comic Book Style, which is basically the method of my madness of how I edit comics, which is very different from my boss, Karen Berger, who has her own style of editing comics, and my first boss, Diana Schutz. And basically the things I picked up along the way. And I can tell you, most of all, the greatest things I learned were from the writers and artists that I worked with. You know, people like Mike Carey, Neil Gaiman, Grant Morrison, Mark Buckingham, Steve Lealoha, Mike Allred, 100% red line drawn under it. One of my best friends in comics, one of my favorite creators in comics, one of my favorite people. Mike is pretty much the older brother I always wanted. And I love telling the story that Mike was also my first friend in comics, because when I was at Kimiko in 1988, having to send out those rejection letters, I was asked to send him one. Mike had sent some of his work to Kimiko because he had wanted to work for the company. And Diana Schutz at that time didn't think he was ready, but asked me to send him a nice note. I wrote him a personal note on the rejection slip, which he still has. And I pretty much said to him, hey, from your art, it's so cool. It looks like you like David Bowie. And of course he did.
Flash forward.
And so we bonded over Bowie. He's been one of my best friends in comics ever since. So I've learned more from those wonderful talents. And it's been such an honor for me to sort of come of age in the 90s with my generation of comics people. And so my goal for all of the things that I put forth about comics now and my personal work is to pay it forward, is to share my experiences. And trust me, it was crazy and fun. You know, I was living in Manhattan in the 90s. I walked a 6-block radius around DC Comics. My mom and I took the cheapest apartment in Hell's Kitchen. And I lived and breathed comics 10 hours a day, every day. But on weekends, you have to believe that I was like on St. Mark's Place.
Oh, yeah.
I just was down there and I never left. I would shop for comics at St. Mark's. I'd go to Kim's Video. I'd eat at Dojo's. I'd hang out at Sounds. I'd go to Trash and Vaudeville. I was like living the ultimate life from 92 until 99. And so that's what the bulk of my memoir is about.
That's awesome. We have some more time, so I'm going to continue to ask the questions. I didn't think we'd get through most of these. So we're doing pretty cool. Doing pretty good.
Wow.
You know, I just want to talk. I just want to talk about what's exciting you right now in comics. I know that we were, you know, talking a little earlier and you said, you know, there's a lot of stuff coming out of the UK that you're really into right now. Talk about what's getting you up in the morning and either sending away for comics or reading digitals, right? Because you can't, harder to shop now.
Well, I'll tell you something. For me, the pandemic has made me even more inspired to make art. And I have a lot of hobbies. So in addition to comics and music being my ultimate, you know, the fiber in my every atom, I also love crafts. So, you know, I've been known to sew a teddy bear or two in my time. People that know me from, I'd say, 2010 to 2015 know I took a drawing that my husband Philip made of a teddy bear, and I thought it was so cute. I brought it to life through sewing it, and I started a side business called Ursa Minor, and I sold teddy bears and had a lot of mad money for a while, which was great. But I turned the crafting side of what I like to do, I sort of put that into insider art. So that's why that was special to me. It wasn't just, oh, let's just do another comics anthology. I love comics anthologies that actually have a conceit and have a story about them. So love of crafts. You probably know that I love tap dancing. And, you know, the only other thing I did in addition to making comics in the 90s was I'd run to a tap class. That's where if I had frustrations, I would imagine certain freelancers' faces on the tap floor. Grant Morrison, I didn't say that, just kidding. Bill Willingham, just kidding. But yeah, that's how I got my frustrations out with some, you know, with sometimes dealing with writers who were late or potential problems. What excites me about comics right now is that it's so easy to make them. It's so easy to find talented collaborators, but you just have to be straight up about your expectations. So if you want to work on, let's say, a platform like Kickstarter, you have to make a commitment to yourself and to your partners that you are going to deliver. And that's the one thing that I see that also sort of sometimes falls apart at the seam with projects that people have in theory. It's going from theory to execution. And I think sometimes that's when a great editor can help you. I think a lot of people, maybe people don't need the kind of editor who corrects their grammar. You know, perhaps they've got that area, but they need more of a coach. So I always find that if you make a list of expectations and you share that with any collaborator and in any kind of business, I mean, top five things that are important to you. You know, for me, it's respect. It's also proof of receipt. And I know, Vita, we talked about that. So much is lost in written communication on email. by not saying got it. And in the old days, I sound like I'm 80, but you know, before we had computers, we had the phone, and I would call people all the time, and that is a lost art. There's so much lost between communicating by voice and by picture. So when we can't do that, if you're just communicating on email, for the love of any God, please write back to people who send you a note and say, got it, back to you soon. Because that's the number one complaint I have in working with people in any medium. You're never 100% sure if somebody's gotten your message. And if you're not sure, you can't move to the next step. And again, like the forward imperative, when you're making a comic, you're building a book. You can't get to page 6 until you get through pages 1 to 5. So I think those are two key things that I ask people who want to work with me. What are your expectations? Do we have a mutual respect for each other? Do we have a similar vision? Mm-hmm. You know, there are a lot of people that want to tell comic book stories that don't appeal to me. And I'm not a big superhero person. You know, anyone who knows me at all knows that. But I am interested in what sometimes people do to rally against the standard superhero tropes. Like, I love The Boys TV show. I think that's like one of the best comics to TV adaptations. And I didn't even read the entire comic, but I love that approach and that study of fascism. I think it's terrific. I like Umbrella Academy a lot too. So I can look at the superhero genre. What might interest me is somebody completely pulling its head off and then ripping its throat apart and then stuffing something else in it. And I know I'm being violent on purpose, but I'm thinking like Burroughs, I'm thinking of David Bowie, circa Station to Station. Mm-hmm. Write it down, rip it up, toss it in the air, and let the confetti fall where it may. That appeals to me. What can we say about this topic that's new? Because I'm so tired of the same old drama and vitriol, and in a lot of cases, garbage that we've seen in the world, socially, politically, and in fiction. Here we have this wonderful medium, you know, of storytelling where we can choose what we say and show. They can contradict each other, they can complement each other, they can defy each other, but it's an art form unlike any other. How can we use it to our advantage to entertain and educate? Those are the big things that I'm into. And Joe Strummer. I think it's the right moment to bring out my Joe Strummer pillow.
I think it's time.
I also make pillows, not for sale. But Vita, I've threatened to make you a pillow with your favorite album cover. So you definitely have to tell me. I'm making this for you for Christmas. You got to give me some ideas.
Okay, I will do so. It'll probably be Dirty Computer because the cover to that is phenomenal. Okay.
No problem.
I have two more things because we are running low on time. Unfortunately, this is I believe this is the first spotlight panel you've ever had. So I want to cram as much into it as I can, but also I want to, you know, we'll leave them wanting more.
Okay.
But, so my two questions are, one of them, you know, is coming, right? It's the, I always try and ask this on panels, what question do you
which I spoiled twice already, by the way.
but you have to bring it together. You seeded it, right? Like in a comic, you seeded it earlier.
Now I tried. Foreshadowing. I tried to foreshadow it. Yes.
So what question do you wish people would ask you on panels? And what is your answer to that question?
Well, I love this question so much. And basically, I love when people ask me what my dream project is, because my dream project has not changed. My dream project since 1992, perhaps, is that I've always wanted to do a history of The Clash and Big Audio Dynamite. And trust me when I tell you, Vita, I've been trying every year since 1992 to get the attention of Mick Jones, because I'm certain that both Mick and Joe, and probably the other band members, love comics. I mean, all you have to do, and I'm going to just, I was thinking I was going to show you, but I must have cleaned up my desk. Look at the lyric sheets on the albums. You know that The Clash loved to draw and make comics and write. And I can't imagine Mick Jones not wanting to tell the story of one of the greatest bands in the world in a graphic novel form, because I'm told that he actually loves comics, reads comics, and people have seen him at comic shops in London. So I've had times in my career where I get this close. Oh. I've had chats with different managers. I've sent him Vertigo books. I've had people tell me that they've told him that there's this crazy editor who thinks he's just amazing and wants to tell his story. No luck. So if Mick Jones is watching, or if the spirit of Joe Strummer wants to come along and take his pillow away from me, I'm all about it. Because if there's one thing I like to do is share my musical icons with the world. And I just think it'd be so cool to not only do the history of The Clash in a graphic novel form, but also I'd love to do the history of DFA Records. And I've written to James Murphy, and I've spoke to his studio mates, sent over lots of comic books, did the same with David Bowie, and actually met with David Bowie's manager, I think in about 2011. David Bowie's manager was in the same office building as my dermatologist. You can't make this up. And I had a meeting with him, and the manager was amazing, and he loved the comics. I brought him Heavy Liquid. I brought him a lot of Paul Pope's comics. And the manager looked me in the he looked me in the eye. He said, look, Bowie loves comics. One of two things is going to happen. I'm going to send him your comics and you're going to hear from me next week, or you probably won't hear from me again because he's very busy. And sure enough, I never heard back, but I was really delighted to hear that, like, Bowie's son, Duncan Jones, is into comics and he's doing comics. Like, it just goes to show you that, like, you know, the musicians are out there, and many of them have a great love and respect for the comic book medium. Many of them don't know that it's still not capes and tights. And I was shocked to find in 1988 that there was a comic book boom. There were black and white books. There were books like Elektra Assassin. You know, when I walked into a comic book store and saw Bill Sienkiewicz's Elektra Assassin cover, I thought I fainted. And I couldn't believe my eyes. I couldn't believe that this was comics. And it was one of the reasons why I'm here, why I decided this was my career path. And by the way, Vita, in case you were worried, I'm not going anywhere. I mean, I am so happy to be back to my indie comics roots. I had no idea I would be working for corporate comics for 23 years. And I certainly wouldn't have joined Vertigo if Karen Berger wouldn't have paved the way for the Vertigo line and for doing cool comics and encouraging me. You know, she really let me hone my own skills and edit my own books and curate my own type of books. You know, Winter's Edge was one of the first anthologies I did for Vertigo, and we did three of them. That was all mine. I wanted to do an anthology because I love anthologies. It's a chance to test people. It's a chance to try a new artist out, or try a new, or have a new writer perhaps try a different style of writing. And it's a way to find out if you, if you're a small idea can grow into a larger idea and perhaps become a regular series. So I'm in it to stay. One of the other things I wanted to tell you is that if I'm down, I try to be positive, but obviously the world at large can throw rocks at us. And what I always say to people when they ask me, like, what do you do when you feel kind of bummed out about the state of things in comics or outside? I say, read comics. This book, Maids by Katie Skelly, blew my mind. Now, of course, I was a film major snob in college, so I saw the film. So I couldn't wait to see what would happen in Katie Skelly's hands. Katie is a genius. And if you don't know her work, I highly recommend you pick this up. This is, in my opinion, her greatest work to date. And she also did a tarot deck that is hands down my favorite tarot of all time. So my advice is, seriously, when you're depressed, pick up a book, or as I like to tell people, shut up and read. There's enough complaining and there's enough vitriol. Put on a great album. For me, the album that always makes me step up and swing is The Clash Sandinista. I don't care what anyone says. It's all killer, no filler. Those three albums are necessary. Vita, if you're going to disagree with me, I'm going to cut us off.
I would never. I was laughing because I have, I don't have a huge vinyl collection, but that is some of my vinyl. In fact, the second vinyl I ever bought myself.
I have to also give you props. Your Keith Haring shirt is just the best, by the way.
Thank you. One of my favorite artists. And I grew up in the Lower East Side, so that was my area.
Well, I love it. And honestly, I was so delighted when I heard that you were going to be moderating this panel. I feel so honored because, Vita, you are one of the true, new, amazing voices in comics, full stop.
you're making me blush.
You are such a great writer. And you and I were talking about this yesterday. One thing I want to see for the future of comics is I want people to be hired because they're tremendous writers, and tremendous writers can write in many different voices, in many different styles. So Vita, I hope someone has the balls to ask you to write John Constantine Hellblazer, to ask you to write The Punisher. I mean, my favorite Punisher writer is Becky Cloonan, and I'll bet you would give her a run for your money.
Oh no, I love Becky Cloonan's Punisher. The dream that I always laugh about with the DC editors that are buddies of mine is that I would love to do a John Constantine, Renee Montoya crossover comic. Just full.
Well, they should have the balls. They should have the balls to let you do it. And if they're really trepidatious, have them put an anthology together. You know, again, it's a great way to showcase small doses. Let's see if you can really do it. You know, who doesn't like a great challenge? To me, that's what's disappointing about comics today. We don't have long form. Long form was it was the best thing about working for Vertigo, because we could hire people and we could ask them to set up a year of events. So you could say, what are your three storylines for your Hellblazer run, Vita? And then we could help you block them. We could help you do an outline. We could work, you know, we could hire guest artist issues and hire people like Mike Allred, people who might not have time to do a full run, but could do guest artist issues, Lucy Sullivan, you know, people, bring women, more women to draw typically male drawn comics. Come on, we can do better and we should do better. And I hereby challenge your editors to step up, make it happen.
That's the perfect way to end this panel. So I wanted to say thank you so much for asking me to moderate Baltimore Comic-Con. And Shelly, thank you so much for just being awesome all the time.
Hey, and thank you. No, thank you for being awesome. It's been such a blast to talk to you, Vita. And thank you, Baltimore Comic-Con, for giving me my first spotlight panel.
I want it's to thank amazing. Both of you, Shelly and Vita. Just as sitting around watching all the comments in the comment section, it wasn't questions. It was just gushing love of how great this panel was. Oh. And everybody was just like, this is the most amazing thing. Somebody chimed in, like they joined in a little bit late and they're like, oh my God, I just stumbled onto the greatest thing on the internet right now. I'm telling all my friends.
It's going to so be great.
Everybody YouTube, just right? adored it. You guys, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much. Everyone have a lovely evening. Enjoy the rest of Baltimore Comic Con Live. And also to Ash and Jackal, I will let Teeny know.
I saw that one too. I want to remind everybody, this panel hall will be closing up, but I want to tell everybody to head on over to the Ringo Hall. We're doing a two-hour Mike Ringo pre-red carpet kind of special. So it's just going to be honoring Mike Ringo leading up to the Ringo Awards at 8 o'clock tonight with Kevin Smith and Jeff Johns and everybody. It's all going to be streaming live. So definitely check it out. But starting right now is the red carpet pre-show. So thanks a lot guys for being here, and we'll definitely call you next time.
Awesome. Thank
you. Everybody be safe and be well. All right.
All right.
Bye, everyone.